All right, here we're in Metamodern Music. This place is awesome. Look at this.
All right. Record store day bins. They're looking for anything. Hold on, there's something really big in here. Oh, look at that one. Pretty awesome.
Nice decor. In Cincinnati, man, this is the first time I've been here. This place was incredible. A lot of new, but there's also a nice selection of used, all genres, including a nice African section. They have which, what more can you ask for? Wonderful shot.
Good morning and welcome back to another early morning Sunday show. Lots of great stuff as usual, but it is a catless episode. I'll shut it off. Hey, I got you in at least for the introduction. That's pretty good. It's like 5-6 degrees out, and you know, cat likes to go out in the morning, but he didn't want to come in. He must have smell something, see something. Something has his interest out there, so it doesn't matter how cold. And let's face it, to cat, the world really is one big litter box. And well, better than using the litter box inside. Get out there and crap away. I don't care. So, cat's not here. Should save about 5 minutes. So, a couple things. We'll talk about the record store that I showed. First off, though, last week I showed a VCLT, and I said the wrong name. I showed this album here. This is Rolling Stones. It's a beautiful, can't get no satisfaction, 55th anniversary EP. This came from Thunderbolt 24. That's Ernie. Ernie Thunderbolt 24 had sent this. And Ernie, I used the wrong name. I don't know what to have. I messed up. It happens more and more, it seems like. So, thank you. Thank you very much, Ernie, for that Thunderbolt 24. Appreciate it. At the beginning, I showed, I was in Cincinnati. I just stayed overnight. I don't work in Cincinnati anymore, but I usually fly out of there once a month. And so I decided, you know what, I'm just going to stay at a different hotel in a different part of town. And when I get there, I'm just going to see what kind of record stores around. I hadn't hit one in Cincinnati for a while. Generally, I go to Platinum Records in Cincinnati or Shake It Records. Both of them incredibly good stores that I truly enjoy. So I went to a new spot in Cincinnati. It's in a suburb area called Oakley. And I hit my phone, my Yelp, and it says there is a place called Metamodern Music. So I went there, one of those great neighborhoods, kind of gets close to college, it was on a side street. And I went in there, walk in, and the owner, his name's JC, is working behind the counter. I go, hey, how you doing? You know, it's 6, he's closing at 7, 1 hour left. That's my normal time. I'm coming in toward the end of the day. You know, you go in toward the end of the day because that way you're limited to how much you're going to spend. And I just had the most incredible hour. I had such a fun time in there. JC, the owner of Metamodern Music, was extremely friendly, extremely helpful. I asked him, and this is something I tell anybody, just go and ask them, what are they listening to? What is appealing to them? Now, regretfully, they always then ask me, well, what do you like to listen to? Well, I don't know. I don't know what I like to listen to because it's so much. I said, well, I don't do death metal and I don't really do heavy metal, if that helps. Otherwise, the world's an oyster, right? Open it up. Let's see what we got. Maybe there'll be a prize. And so he took me around the shop. We talked, and I just had a great time. When I had my purchases at the end, this is when you know you're in trouble. when the person looks and says, would you like a box? You know you've screwed up and you have too much. I got to get it onto a plane. I found I couldn't pack that box. I had to take them out of the box anyway. I bought a lot of interesting things I would not have known about. There was some stuff I saw that I know that I want, but there was a lot of things I hadn't seen. And, you know, the store was filled. You know, there was used and new. Just really fascinating. So a couple things that JC gave me, a couple of these very cool stickers. Here's this t-shirt, Metamodern Music. Is that, now this is one hell of a quality t-shirt. Look at the stitching and stuff. I mean, it's really, really nice. Long sleeve, which I absolutely love because I'm always cold. Cool slip mat. Just toss that in. And he was very, very nice. And I'll talk more about these. Kiaka Guhu Moyo tossed in this album of theirs. And this one from Alabaster de Plume. I'm not going to go over, I will be going into these in later episodes, but they're really cool albums, very interesting music that deserves some time. I have to digest it. I've played them both, but I need to digest it and think about what we're going to talk about on those. So if you're in Cincinnati, Cincinnati has, you know, like I said, three great record stores I know of. Metamodern Music over in the Oakley area in Cincinnati. Well worth a visit. Go and say hi to JC. Very, very nice person. I'm really impressed with him. Great time. Really, really good. So, JC, thank you if you're watching. Alrighty. Hey, one other thing. Finished this book, Punk Avenue, and by Phil Marcade. He was the lead drummer, then a lead singer, played guitar for a group called the Senders. If you're interested in the early punk rock scene in New York, Phil, he came out of France, and he was a part of it, and he was there when it all started, and this is filled with stories. Steve from FlipSideCT turned me onto this, and it was just a great book, really fast read. I read it basically in 2 days on my flights this week, so 2 days of flying. One day I gave up my seat, and someone got $1,000 gift certificate that I might put onto Amazon, though my wife might say, well, we're doing the bathroom, maybe we should do it to that. $1,000 in Amazon music? Whew. We'll see. Great book. Really good interest. Very, very interesting book. So I bought this off Amazon. Really nice read. And then Steve, you know, again from FlipSideCT, sent me this. A Blues Odyssey by Bill Wyman. Love these kind of books where we travel, we look at things. But not only that, this is just, it's a treasure trove about the blues and about the artists in the blues. This is going to be absolutely a dynamite read. So thank you, Steve. Very, very nice. I love books. That means now I'm going to have to take another book out of my bookshelf to replace this book. I may have to wind up buying another bookshelf. I put those in my living room, though. I got a bunch of these that I can move. Yeah, okay, we're working on that. All right, next, let's begin with, I was sent this a while back, and I'm finally getting around to showing it. This came from a new channel. Justin from DJ Tapefire sent me this, and I showed it briefly, but I didn't talk about it. The group is called Gel Soul, and it's called Horsehead Bookends. Gel Soul Horsehead Bookends. Now this is neat. If you don't like that cover, right? Say, hey, yeah, I've seen that cover. I want something different. You can do this. Maybe. There we go. I can decide that I want the cover. All right, got here's the back of it. Maybe I want it to look like this. Or I want it to look like this. Or I say, I want my cover to look like this. But then, that would be fun. Look at this. this is like every day of the month. This is like a day of the month. This is like a month club. You know, every month you could put on a different cover and always have something cool and exciting to look at, because this artwork is absolutely fabulous. Isn't that just fun? Man, that is so neat. So, you know, without it, you know, just kind of blank. It's just it's like your own picture. Very, very cool. But so Gel Soul, Andrew Reichel, might be saying that one wrong. Ooh, big surprise. He's out of Seattle. And he's a longtime composer. And what he does is he creates soundscapes. And it's just filled with wild improvisations. And I probably should. This one does have Nightlife in Sweden. Oh, that's kind of fun. We'll just hold up one of these so you can see something besides me. What he does is he samples lots of music when he does this. And he calls his sampling, what do you call it? Plunderphonics. So he uses plunderphonics as he finds his stuff. And so it's like a mix of space rock, shall we say Berlin style, Berlin School electronics. R&B funk is tossed in there. Avant-garde. There is some dub. There's even some minimalism. Toss in a little oregano, some basil, and a little cayenne. You got one hell of a good stew happening here on music. Horsehead Bookends, the name of this album, came out in 2017. And Andy, he plays every instrument in it. And it's just crazy sounds. There's a lot of prog elements going on, and the music, it flows from one song to the next. At times, really, it has kind of a cool Pink Floyd when they were really experimental feel to it. I even think of Osric Tentacles, but yet you all get kind of minimalism at times. There's a voice samples tossed in there that kind of give it this kind of eerie, different kind of feel to it. Incredibly cool stuff. Something I never in a million years would have found or bought. And but Justin, DJ Tapefire, I can check out his channel. This is the kind of stuff he listens to and comes up with. And that's what makes it exciting about his channel. I pick up neat things. And so Justin, this was just such a, gosh darn, this was fun. Listen, so if you're looking for something really different, just it's again more instrumental, put this thing on and just enjoying the back. Kind of a, you know, like Osric Tentacles, Pink Floyd, that kind of feel, electronic. It's it. Really good stuff. Seeger Noah. Yeah, that's an OG. Now, the thing is, whoever, you know, you cutouts, someone decided to use a drill press and shot it right through Bob's face. That's the sad part. The spine, there is some tape there, which is kind of amazing because really, you look at the album, gosh, it's clean, it's nice, it's really neat. It's on Capitol. Right there, you can see it. This is Bob Seger's second album. Came out in 1969. At this time, Bob was having a hard time. He's kind of worn out from all the traveling and everything. This is 69. Bob Seger wore out. You think of the road warrior he is. But he had taken on all this responsibility, and he was just having a tough time. So he brought in another guy named Tom Nimm. N-E-M-E, Nim, Nime, who knows, to come and help. Well, the record company, they like Tom. Tom's great. We think Tom's fantastic. He needs to be singing some songs, playing some tunes. And there was almost like an insurrection of Tom taking over the Bob Seger sound system. So this album, what makes it interesting, is it's like half Tom, half Bob. which to some, it gives it, it's definitely uneven because you have numbers on there that are extremely rock and roll. In Intravenous Eyes, it was done by Bob Seger, that's just straight ahead, hard rocking. But you get to side two, which is more Tom. Jumping, humping, hip, hypocrite. It's extremely psychedelic. You just have that real feel to it. Side two was Tom was taken more into a psychedelic type feel, while Bob wanted more rock and roll. There's the song Cat. It goes on for 6 minutes, and that thing's just a piece of crap. It's just this a percussion thing going on with some noises and cat sounds, and it sounds like someone's having sex, and maybe two cats are having sex. I'm not sure, but it was just like pure garbage, in my personal opinion. So there's some songs that are real throwaways on here, and others are good. There's Lenny Johnson, which is a nice ballad that's done by Tom. So it was... it's a fairly uneven record, but it's an insurrection happening. Well, Tom then was kicked out, left, I don't know, whatever the case, but he was gone. He just did this one album, but hard album to find. Seeger fans, really, this is one of those kind of grail things. I had Seeger 67, lost it in the flood. That was an OG, but it's fun to get this from a guy here in town. Next one. There's a channel out there. His name's Corey, Just Add Final. He has a thing called Hard and Heavy. And Corey, he's out of Columbus, Ohio, and I've had the pleasure to go picking with him. He showed this a while back, and a lot of other people have, and I've never found it until I was at a store in Detroit last week, and there it was, Heavy Equipment by Euclid. I've been looking for this for over a year. It just hasn't been available through Amazon or anything. I've never seen it in a record store, and ta-da, there it was. So Euclid comes out of Massachusetts. This is, they did one album, and this is their one album. And I believe it came out in like 1970. They formed like in 69. Euclid, they say, is named after a trucking company. Thus, Heavy Equipment seems like a good way. What's interesting, this group, this is a hard rock group. There was usually a minimum of three guitarists. These guys like to play hard. It's bludgeoning. That's just called bludgeoning post-psychedelic hard rock. It's heavy. It's Heavy Equipment. There is, you know, they do have pop-like harmonies on here. You know, there was a song like On the Way, and they harmonize beautiful. It has this nice feel, but mostly it's just heavy and thick. They do the song Gimme Some Lovin', you know, gimme some lovin' every day, except they do it in such a way, it's like slams you in the face, kicks you in the gut and say, hey man, we need it heavier. Really cool album. I've looked for this for a couple years, and there it was. I go, holy crap. So I got it. That's Euclid. If you like that 70s hard rock, this had been shown for a while in the BC. It was big. Everyone showed it but me. Chalk me on the list now, okay? Great stuff.
Yeah.
you Tales from the Crate showed this. See, we're, I'm showing a bunch of stuff. Again, you know, the VC, that's the prompt, great thing about the vinyl community. They inspire you to spend money. That's right, they inspire you to spend money. And Andrew showed this, El Rego. Tales from the Crate. The guy that does the that does our vinyl tag, neat, great album. This is it's 1245s from El Rego, and there were hits he had in the 60s and 70s. He has a James Brown feel. I mean, look at him. He was in kind of getting that James Brown look, and so he has a wow. Wow, in his own voice out there, and he does that quite often. It's kind of fun, actually. He's from Benin in Western Africa, and I've discussed Benin a lot. It's not a big country, but these guys brought the funk in. They took between the Kudi and the high life music, and they put it together, and they really made a funky mix, and that country really had incredibly good music. Now, El Rego's real name is Theophile Dalrego. That's his true name. El Rego is much more easier, and his group is Ses Commandos. Yeah, Ses Commandos. You know, this song, it was the government, they had taken over things. He has one song on here. What's it called? Trying to find it here. Vive la Renova. It's French. It's Vive the Revolution. The government arrested El Rego, and they says, hey, you want out of jail? You need to write a song about our government, our Marxist revolution that happened in 72. So for him to get out of jail, he had agreed to do a 45 about the Marxist revolution and how great it was. You gotta love government sometimes. So he went and he did it, and it did well. It made it on here, but I'm sure the government promoted it really well. This is a raw, soulful type album. Again, there's a lot of West African rhythms happening within there, and it was put out by Daptone, which is fun to see. There's so much great music, nothing exciting in there, so much great music currently coming out from Africa from different labels, and Daptone jumped in with this, El Rego. Jazz for those jazz lovers, Freddie Hubbard, Hubtones. This was a nice pickup, part of the the Blue Note series, I think the 80s series. Freddie Hubbard out of Indianapolis, actually, you know, he started playing with West Montgomery because West Montgomery's from Indianapolis, and so they played together. But in 58, he wound up going to New York, where he got together, roomed with Eric Dolphy in New York City. By 60, he had formed his own group, though he was still working with other people. I mean, let's think about this. Freddie Hubbard, he played on Coltrane's Ascension. He was on Herbie Hancock's Maiden Voyage, and Eric Dolphy's Out to Lunch. Three incredible classics that he was a part of. Well, Hubtones, this came out in 1962, and he teamed up with James Spalding, who plays alto sax and flute. He also had Herbie Hancock on piano on here, Reginald Workman bass, Clifford Jarvis on drums. Really fun album. What you see on here, so it's a little different. He'd been listening to a lot of Coltrane, and Coltrane's modal music was a huge influence. So this album, what he does is he's pushing the modern jazz, but not going avant-garde. But still, he's pushing it some. So it's just not straight ahead like bop, bebop. There's more to it that's happening. Songs like You're My Everything is just, I mean, it's just a ferocious swinging kind of classic. Hubtones is awesomely cool. That thing really, really swings. But then you have like Prophet Jennings or Lamet for Booker. You know, Prophet Jennings is a real fluty thing. So it's a lot quieter. And Michael, I apologize for saying anything bad about the flute there. I like the flute. Then Lamet for Booker is just a soft, kind of a quiet, bout of the death of a friend. So, cool album. Very, very nice. Freddie Hubbard's put out a lot of great stuff. He was a heck of a trumpet player. Good pickup, and hope you enjoyed the sample of that. Here and we're done. Soundtrack. Django. I used to have tons of soundtracks and CDs. That's where I picked them up. I learned a lot of music. I learned a lot of groups from picking up soundtracks. With Django Unchained. Everyone remembers that movie, right? There were so many people killed, so much blood. It was incredible. Quentin Tarantino, of course. Came out in 2012. This thing is just, it's a variety of genres, but the focus is on spaghetti westerns. There are seven times on here there's dialogue. And, dialogue's good the first time. Then after, I guess you can memorize it. I could do without it. When I want music, I don't want someone to sit there just talking. But it's Django, and that was a great movie. I really, really liked it. And Ennio Morricone, he did some of the music on here. John Legend does one. Who did that? Who did that to you? Really, really neat song. I love that one. 100 Black Coffins, and Rick Ross did that, produced it. Just a fun soundtrack. Found it there in beautiful condition. I love this movie, and Ennio Morricone, I love the spaghetti western stuff he did. You know, they've reissued a lot of these Morricone things. Yeah, I'd like to buy. We only have so much money. Personally, I'd like to have them, but then can't buy something else. Finally, Spaceman 3 Recurring. I saw this. I think Sam Finotusha sold this. Was it Rob or Beggy Hi-Fi? I've seen it on some other channels, and gosh darn, I couldn't remember quite where. This was their last album from Spaceman 3. It came out in 1991. Recurring is what's called. And basically, the band had already been broken up when they did this. So side one was done by Peter Kemper, side two by Jason Pierce. And thus, this album is uneven. It's two solo albums, two sides. They did not help each other. They just came in, they did their own thing, and they left. People didn't know they had broken up, but there was. So, you think, though, sometimes when this happens, there's this tension, there's kind of a destruction, there's all this drama, great music can be made. Think of Let It Be by the Beatles. What was going on then? Great music was made. There's some very good songs on here. It's not bad. It's different from the other Spaceman 3. You could hear Jason Pierce going into Spiritualized, his group that he would form after this. It was happening. His music was forming into that. So you don't have this heavy distortion of early Spaceman 3. This is a little more quieter, a little more electronic, I felt. But it was just fun to hear each of them explore. Is this a must-have Spaceman 3? I'd say no. Their first few albums really are the best, and just a group I like, so Recurring. did it. Thank you very much, everyone hanging out. Cat's still outside freezing his ass off. His fault. He has fur, right? So thanks. I'm going to have another contest entry, I think, later on this week for Michael, Notable and Archive. So noted in Archive. Sorry, Michael. Thank you, everyone. Cheers. Have a great week.